the floor is open. Yes, sir. Okay, that's for you. All right. Let's take about four or five questions.
Well, I think the first step is to learn as much as you can about African history and culture. And my hope as a historian and as an educator is that we move more towards the operationalization of history. Whenever in all of my classes, I always have students, when they introduce themselves, tell me why they took the class. And oftentimes the response is, well, I want to learn more about my culture. I want to learn more about my history. To me, to know is not enough. Point of the information is how do you use this information to change and hopefully better your conditions. So knowing is not enough. So first, I would say to access the information. And as you access it, find ways to internalize it and operationalize it so that it serves your best interest and, in my opinion, the best interest of our people.
Can I just add to that a little bit? I would also just say, so I took some students to Ghana in October, and they were walking around Accra, and they were like, man, this is so interesting. I wish that we had more African history available to us. And I was like, listen, it's available every semester. I teach multiple classes every semester, and a lot of my colleagues teach multiple classes every semester in African history. These courses are there, right? They're there and they're available, and there's opportunities to travel. So come do study abroad with us, because we're actually going to be doing some of that, right? We're actually going to take the knowledge, the history, and we're going to translate it into something that's meaningful, right? For you and for people in Accra. So there's opportunities out there, and I encourage everybody to take advantage of the opportunities that exist, because we can only offer them when you take advantage of them.
Okay, that's good. All right. Yes, please.
The personal side of the question.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm Dr. Kumasi, so I'm actually so filled with joy I'm able to visit Ghana in a month on a trip that actually your colleague Daphne's Terry kind of helped me coordinate. So I'm excited about that. And my father was a black intelligentsia during the 70s here. He taught at WC3 African studies. He's passed, but I think he would be glad that I'm starting my process of re-African relations. So that's my side. But to Professor Chike, can you elaborate on the difference between continental African and was it diaspora? And then for you, I was wondering if you could elaborate on the demographics of the gentrification. Is it like Detroit where you have the sort of white hippies from the outskirts coming in, or is it more, I don't know the dynamics, so I'm just curious because it sounded similar, but it sounded like it might be the black version of what we have here in Detroit.
Do we prefer to respond immediately to every question, or is that what you
can respond to?
Okay, all right, go ahead. Yeah, I think it gives it more immediacy.
Yeah.
So let's let them respond to her. And what you might do also, please tell us who you are. I mean, at least your name, if you're taking one of our courses, by all means, confess as much. Yeah, so very quickly.
Continental African is an African that was raised, grew up, lived in Africa. And the diasporic African is an African that was raised, grew up, lived in the diaspora. I also assert that there's enough commonalities in the culture of either that we can both, I can substantiate that we're both still African people.
Yeah, that's a really good question. And it's actually really interesting. I think it's one of those ways that it's actually, if we look at a situation like Accra, it actually forces us to re-interrogate the way we're talking about stuff that's happening in Detroit and what's at the root of what's going on. So absolutely, I wouldn't say it's not entirely, but it's by and large not white people driving this kind of gentrification, right? This is largely upper class Ghanaians, African-American returnees, or people who are second-generation Ghanaians who grew up in the U.S. and are going back to Ghana now. So they were often born in the U.S., but their parents are Ghanaian, Macmillan citizenship instead of going back. That's not to say that there's not a growing class of Europeans or foreigners in the city. It's many more than used to be. And they're certainly a lot more present than they used to be, a lot visible. I used to never see anybody.
It's called globalization.
Yeah.
Let me just add a quick thing here. We have to be aware of two things. First of all, the diasporization and the connection between diaspora and the continent is not evenly spread across the Americas, for instance.
Yeah.
That certain politics and cultures historically have a much stronger presence of Africa and Africana than others. I mean, let's take Cuba and Brazil. Cuba did not abolish slavery until 1886. Brazil did not abolish slavery until 1888. United States abolished slavery, not slavery, the trade, much earlier. Mm-hmm. Brazil and Cuba kept getting illegal trade Africans coming to Brazil and Cuba, which meant to a certain extent that there was much more of a renewal of religious, cultural, from Africa in some of these places than say was the case in the United States. So one has to keep that in mind. What is changing now, I see, that even places which you should talk much about the African presence, or places where the African presence was negated, like Argentina, now, for the first time, through globalization and through movements within the Americas themselves, you know, there are new visions or new ideas about Africa emerging. What we have to keep in mind is that, as he implied, it's not just a knowledge that there's a dynamism involved, so that we don't end up with what I call frozen Africa.
Yes, sir. Could you introduce yourself?
Yes, I had a question about how you're asking, when you're explaining the new development in the city. Are they like doing about a community, because you talked about the problem too, so are they doing any community outreach and giving back to the community within the lower class community, which is the majority?
Yeah, so it's there's definitely some, and I think the group of people that I'm talking about in terms of this creative working class group of people definitely are doing a lot more community engagement, right? So there's a great thing called the Jamestown Walking Tour, for example, which caters to foreigners and visitors to the city, but they use the money that they raise to help support a cultural center in Jamestown, one of the poorest districts of the city. There's people that run a website called African Urbanism and are involved in a lot of these communities that have created photography workshops for kids, and they give the kids cameras and take them around and encourage them to create art, right? There's other people that are using sports to help provide new opportunities for kids. A lot of this is happening in Jamestown. And so yeah, especially the kind of creative folks are doing a lot to reach out to try to help some of the kids in Jamestown who often can't afford to go to school or have kind of limited schooling and have parents that have to work a lot and a bunch of other stuff, right? So they're trying to provide some opportunities for them to engage and create community and kind of feel empowered in a new way, because a lot of the really exciting stuff that's happening in the city right now is happening in Jamestown, but it often doesn't include the people of Jamestown. So it's like outsiders. So there's this big arts festival called Chali Wote, and it's gotten tons of international attention, but it's run by a bunch of people who are relatively elite artists, and it's really exciting, but these people are pretty elite, right? And so they're kind of walking through this super poor district, and they bring all these people from all over the world to walk through this poor district, and people are taking photographs. And so it's, you know, it created this tension. So I think out of that comes this desire to kind of connect with the community and to try to bring, especially the children, into some more of the opportunities that are available.
Yes. Could you actually introduce yourself? Name, perhaps?
Yes, my name is Karen Sanders. I'm an artist, a media artist, I'm a professor at the University of Texas. Back here in Detroit.
Okay.
Trying to make sense of things.
Yeah.
And I'm also Kefentse's cousin. And my question has to do with the juxtaposition of history and historians, the rehashing of data that already exists, and continues to operate as the authority, an authoritative manner to organize our thoughts about our identities, in relationship to each other, and the lack of new knowledge doesn't get put into currency with regard to what's needed to decry the delusional myth of Eurocentric authority.
Mm-hmm.
Follow?
Mm-hmm.
And it really bothers me that things are often and continues to be put into that frame. And so as historians, I'd like to understand, like you said, that you're often not concerned with the future, when in fact you're creating the future by reassessing that the same information that has been put out there, right? And in this day and age, in my opinion, the necessity for new knowledge is central to the survival of this democracy, this so-called democracy that is America, but also in terms of the way it affects the rest of the world, because the globalization is real. It's something that's not going to be turned back. And in that, there continues to be an effort to define and normalize the authority that is defining this globalization. When in fact, the reality of globalization has nothing to do with the way it's being described.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
Like, these individuals that you may have encountered, they have no idea that they are being fit into that kind of a formula. You can't deduce their activities of survival into a formula that complies with this grand idea of globalization. The fact is that the fact is that globalization is about the continuous birth of people of color.
Mm-hmm.
Necessary, to be a part of mainstream, whatever mainstream is, and this idea that, that people are becoming more urbanized to fit what's happening with globalization that's a myth.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a part of the new knowledge that's necessary to talk about people's identity, our identity,
mm-hmm.
that is self-proclaimed. It's
mm-hmm.
necessary. That's the new knowledge.
Yeah.
To investigate the self-proclaiming of identity throughout the world with people of color.
Yeah.
Shall we take that as a comment?
I'm asking.
Raises a number of profound issues. Okay. New knowledge. It's all very well, but the most profound contestations are about how you interpret and use existing and old knowledge. And this country is a very good example of that. Sankofa is precisely that. That if you walk away from the accumulated knowledge which has been deployed hegemonically. And I think Mr. Trump is a very, very good example of how existing and old forms of knowledge can come and hit us right to the side of the head if we not careful, these days they call it alternative facts. You know, but that's a very interesting comment. Did you want to say something very quickly?
Well, it was a very, you said a lot.
Yeah.
But what came to my mind is the colonization of knowledge and information, particularly as it pertains to empire. So the emergence of intellectual perspective like Afrocentricity and others, which deconstruct existing bodies of knowledge, are designed, I think, try to do what it is that you advocate for. But I think empire clamors to hold on to the status quo because it's about the retention of power. And if we look at what's playing out in contemporary politics, at least in my opinion, and I swear, I tell my students every week that I'm not going to let Donald Trump come into the conversation. But somehow, it's almost like I need a 12-step program to get out of that. But what I see happening is, and as you suggested, this emergence of the status quo, or white men trying to retain their power, as you get, in America, for example, you get increasing diverse populations, which pose a threat. And it's not just happening in the United States, because the Brexit piece in England, you have a conservative right-wing movement in France, and now they're even saying there's the emergence of it in, well, not to the same degree in Russia, but Russia is increasingly becoming like the last vestige of a pure white race. And so these people feel threatened.
I would say too that I'm totally with you. So when I say I don't like to talk about the future anymore, like I don't want to predict the future, because that's difficult to do, right? I mean, none of us can. But I think talking about visions of the future is really important. But I also think that, so one of the things about these people certainly, who I know very well, so on the one hand, the global is very much a reality for them, right? They talk actively about the way that global institutions limit the possibilities for their lives, the way that global institutions limit what their national government can do, what development looks like. So one of the things that I'm really interested in and the kind of things I'm trying to think and push back against now are the idea that we take for granted that development means a certain thing, for example, right? That globalization means a certain thing, that urbanism means a certain thing, that transport infrastructure needs to look a certain way, right? That these things don't have to be the hegemonic, right? The hegemonic that we like to impose or assume is universal isn't universal, right? And so I'm really interested in thinking about how people are expressing themselves and the kinds of opportunities and alternatives that they're creating in the city and kind of where they're gaining traction. And, you know, as a historian, we tend to look at kind of structures and systems and institutions, and that's just a limit of kind of what the discipline is in a way. But yeah, I think that a lot of the questions here are really important, and I think they're central to kind of a lot of the challenges of history right now as a discipline.
Yeah, I guess I'm just wondering, how do we help students, millennials, you know, think about themselves as global, active citizens? That happens throughout the rest of the world,
yeah.
You know, with in terms of people of color. We think of themselves as global participants.
Yeah.
Here in the United States, that doesn't happen. They think of themselves as citizens of the, you know,
I think if that's not conceptualized, if power and power relationships are left out of that discussion, then people are going to have a problem.
How can black people conceivably leave power relations out of any conceptualization? It's a point well taken, because you do find that there's much more of a sense of awareness of globality in all of these African countries than there is here. I mean, and part of the problem is media. I mean, it's unbelievable the number of global media outlets that you get in Ghana, Chinese Al Jazeera, BBC. Every morning I go through at least 10 international major TV. Over here, since Al Jazeera folded up in the Detroit area, the only global station we get is BBC. All day. Otherwise, CNN is as constipated and as parochial. Well, okay, now that Mr. Trump is getting on the air, please, I very much jump on that as well. Yes, sir, please. Yes, yes. Start with your name.
Oh, hi, I'm Tristan.
Okay.
Yes, I was major. That's it.
All right.
I just wanted to clarify. So, like, re-Africanization, that's a, so is it like a return to, like, your, like, roots, like, your cultural roots as someone from, like, African descent?
Is that to a degree, yes, it is. But it's the, I think that the process that diasporic Africans particularly have been exposed to throughout the time that we've been here has caused us to suppress our Africanity. And in fact, we not only suppress it, we despise it to a great degree. I can give you a ton of references. We can look at W.E.B. Du Bois as a double tank.
Let's move very quickly. Yes, sir, and then
Oscar, you violated African studies for every student.
For every student?
Senior citizen. The question I have, you know, I'm a retired military, and sometimes I, you know, I look at an African country, look at the size, what's your major activities, relocating, going to load, what kind of equipment you got, and what time it is. And when I look at some things, and the question I'm going to ask is that your troops, your population, our population in the diaspora and in Africa are educated by the Europeans. We are cultivated by the Europeans. We've been defeated by the Europeans. And like Che Guevara said, we've got to throw all of that away. He says that we have to be reasonable and ask for the impossible. We've got to discard all European ideas. And I don't mean the idea that, you know, one and one is two. Actual intellectual facts of the culture of colonialism, imperialism, capitalism, socialism, and just like the African, which you pointed out what we got to do. Go get the basics, go get the real information that was stolen from Africa in the first place. You know, because the European is a master at war, destruction, and death dealing. We fight a war, we win a skirmish, and we relax. They fight 100-year wars, which I heard that's even wrong. 100 years war lasted. The historian could tell them maybe 300 or 400 years. So they never stop fighting, never stop conquering, never give up. And we make a little money and we think we can go global. We can even make up the words that we live by, the way we govern ourselves. And we're not global. They made that stuff up here recently. They've been global since Columbus, before Columbus. All right, let me shut up. The question is, we've got to do the impossible to discard all that.
Okay, I assume that's...
I mean, you've already said this is what we have to do. We Africanize, we vitalize, we structure, we define. We got to do that.
Yeah. But are you responding to that? Otherwise, there are two other people before we get to you.
No, I'm not responding to that.
Okay, all right. So, yeah, please.
Okay, so I have two questions.
Very quickly, yeah.
Okay, so I've taken race and racism, and I'm taking it online, so it's really reading-based. And a lot of the information I learned is like, it's like culture being absorbed is like, has to be a middle ground there. Are we taking back our culture too? I was wondering.
I'll say this, as a short, because you said a lot, I don't know who said, who mentioned the feet.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, you should probably Matt Dugan is sitting downtown, not a black man.
Okay, but you should probably.
Trump is sitting in the White House. Excuse me. Not a black man himself.
Excuse me, young lady. What's your name? You should probably ask the gentleman, you should pose the defeat question to him, because nobody up here posed that.
Well, my short answer to the long statements and several questions you posed were, if you don't know who you are, you can't discern between what is the idea that's indigenous to you or in other people, and what is good for you and what's not.
Yeah, I'm just saying, you outlined that. And what I'm saying is, if somebody drops a bomb on me or burns my house down, I'm not saying I'm defeated, but I got to realize that this guy burned my house down, disorganized my community, dismantled my political system that we had in the 60s, wiped out the Black Panthers, wiped out Martin Luther King. Those are realities, and they have to be faced.
I'm sorry, these debates are going to go on forever, being absolutely out of time, so let's very quickly take the other couple of questions. Hello? Okay, all right. And did you? Yes, in the black belt.
Ash, you talked a lot about.
What's your name?
Whitney Nathan.
Okay.
About the Africanization of people, black people. What about the culture that we built here?
What exactly is your question? What about the culture that we built here?
Yeah, what happened?
My immediate response to that is that we never stopped being African. So the culture that we built here is not exclusive of who we are as African people.
But should we learn to embrace that culture first before
trying
to go to a foreign country and embrace
it? Learn to embrace which culture?
They're not foreign countries.
See, they Indo DNA.
Part of the issue is, we have been socialized and educated away from ourselves so that we don't even really know who we are. That's why I said, if you know who you are, then you're better able to discern which ideas are useful to you and which are not, in terms of what you should do away with and not do away with. And one of the points that I mentioned is when I talked about those three phases of re-Africanization, said the doing away with or the discerning, I don't want to pull it out now just for the sake of time, of European ideas that are not useful to us. I'll just give you an example. In some African cultures, I think it's the Yoruba or Eboe people, once upon a time, it was considered a taboo if twins were born. So they would leave the twins to die in the forest. Now that's an African idea that I don't think is enhances us as African people.
Yeah. Well, we have to be capable, and black people have been preeminently capable, both there and here, of self-criticism and self-critique. We are profoundly self-critical people. Okay, very quickly, and then I'll give you a chance to come back, and the very last contribution will be,
I think one of the realities or issues we have to deal with is also the ability to deal with contradictions. Mm-hmm. That whether it's on the continent, on the diaspora, there are contradictions that we have to deal with this. Secondly, that not all people, either in the continent or even the diaspora, recognize certain things. So the question becomes, what do you do with those kinds of people? Maybe you try to educate them. But Africa, the sheer weight of Africa in the Americas, especially for instance, is so heavy that many times the way that people are dealt with it. So keep that in mind, because you know, I would imagine that those of you who braved the rage to come here this evening have a minimum volition. And see the way that Toma and Cabras, the struggle continues
unabated. Absolutely.
Yes, very quickly, 2 seconds.
Very quick. Oh, okay. Well, just like the Jewish and ideal thing, I mean, you brought up the twin. The twin, or the twin example, you said having twins is like a sin or something like that?
I definitely used that word, but I
don't know what it was. I'm asking. You did say it was like.
It was considered, it was a bad.
Oh, an African culture?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Some of the myths in our culture. Chinese, Europeans.
Well, I would think to the point where you would take them somewhere and just let them die.
Yeah, I said, all primitive cultures.
I said, ancient Romans, if the baby was born, they would put the baby on the floor. So, yeah. So, I mean,
yeah.
It's not an original. We've all been discerning in 21st century as African people moving forward. What can we do? We cannot erase or ignore the fact of what we've been exposed to. So how do we move forward in our best interest? And I contend that when African people operate in their best interest, in historically this bears out that it has contributed to the development of humanity.
What the Grumma calls triple heritage. Don't deny what has happened before. You need to assimilate it from an Afrocentric standpoint. Okay, last contribution.
Thank you. My name is Lori Robinson. My question is for the two elder scholars, senior scholars. Having experienced 60 years of Ghana as an independent nation, I'm interested to know, and it's obviously been a leader, it was a leading African nation in the independence movement. How would you describe its place and its strength of power in terms of the African continent in relation to other African countries and nations, especially in light of the new government, and then globally?
I have a persistent problem. I can hear very well when people are speaking from the floor.
Oh.
I wish the microphone, so could you?
She wants to know.
Okay, maybe
I can translate. she wants to know, since Ghana was such a leader in the nationalist period, in the leading African country, how does Ghana fare 60 years later in terms of African leadership on the continent and world?
As I said at the beginning, you know, it's, I think sometimes Ghana, the idea of Ghana, Ghanaians, we talk and think of ourselves as if we are using the old kind of royalist idea of primogeniture, that the first son who is born is entitled to succeed at everybody else's. And so, here again, that is very important. Once upon a time, we were very important. And we were important in spite of the fact that we were a big country. And we were important because of our smallness. Certain other countries were envious of us. Now, it's almost a plane with the cowrie shells. The cowrie shells are falling all over the place. There are people who now claim to be leaders of Africa because of their size, because of their resources. Some have claimed leadership because they were engaged much more in armed struggle than others. Right now, I don't think Ghanaians are contesting those. Whether it's well, history, geography, the historical moment, and provides citizens. But we continue almost like that historical moment. It's a short issue, a short century, short period, from about 1957 to about 1966. And then since then, we are learning to cope with a certain reality, that reality being a small country on the west coast of Africa, whose fame and history far exceeds those of many other people on the continent. And that is the reason why the rest of the world shows the diaspora when they think of. I think, for us, even in places where like Portuguese speaking countries like this, apart from, say, Cabral and Ghana, Riquez, and then, of course, there are some more recent manifestations of Ghana, whether Kofi Annan speaks or not. No matter what way, if you say Ghana, say, ah, Kofi Annan. So,
or the footballers.
Or the footballers.
The
Brazilians are thinking, oh, yeah. Man, why does this African guy choose to call himself Pelé, forgetting that Pelé himself looks like he come from So, you've asked a question that it's something we Ghanaians ourselves struggle with. It's like, once upon a time, we will. But I don't think we've given up of not being. It's just that we have to find new ways of being now.
You know, that is why, even though he was rejected and removed forcibly with American complicity in 1966, Nkrumah now has become an essential and permanent and huge element of the national psyche. Everybody goes back to that period. But the other change, which is really quite fundamental to what we're discussing, is that all of these debates that we, you know, these things, that these exchanges about, you know, alternative futures and what does it mean, a better Ghana, and so on, used to be very central to Ghana. Ghana's prominence politically and ideologically meant that it was a center of huge global as well as local debates. What to me is saddest of our present reality is that all of that has dissipated. Ghana is no longer a place of these vibrant, vigorous debates and discussion of contradictions and so on. We have been normalized in a way that also has deeply sapped our collective sense of direction and our collective sense of uniqueness. So one of the, when I made a reference to cultural hybridity, one of the things you really see, and maybe you might have seen it even in the presidential inauguration, is just the clash of cultures and the uncomfortable, contradictory, to the extent that I can use that word, synthesis or things that, you know, a grotesque juxtaposition very often of cultures, the old and the stupidly new, all of these newfangled ideas, you know, every crazy notion that comes out there, it's important into Ghana, and you know, all of that. There's a decadence and a helplessness. We become a vessel of just passive receptivity. Okay, so on that.
I want to thank our panelists for the wisdom and contribution and knowledge. But most of all, I want to thank you for coming. I really appreciate you. If you have the opportunity, please consider taking courses in the Department African-American Studies. Get home safe and attend some more of our events this month and for the rest of the semester. Thanks a lot.